Hello, Google Plus developers. I'm Gus Klass, and I'm on developer relations for the Google Plus team. And today we're going to be talking about the Python Quickstart. And so naturally, we brought in one of our Python experts from the Drive team, Ali Afshar.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming.
So a little trivia about Ali is he wrote his own IDE.
So I wrote two IDEs, actually. They're great. You want to check them out. One of them is called Pitta. One of them is called Abominade. They're both written in Python. And you can like them if you like Vim.
There you go. Well, it's great to have you here, Ali. And so let's get to the Quickstart video that we've been working on this week. And so we're going to just take a quick look at it. And it's a screencast that we did to show you how quick it is. The instructions for the Python Quickstart are available on developers.google.com/plus/quickstart-python. The first step in the instructions is to enable the Google Plus API. This is what you do before starting any project. Navigate to code.google.com/APIs console. When you're here, create a new project, and then give your project a title for you. After you create the project, you'll be redirected to the Services pane. Inside of the Services pane, you'll need to turn on the Google Plus API. After turning on the Google Plus API, create a client ID and client secret by navigating to API Access. The information that you enter into this first window will be customer-facing, so carefully pick it. Next, set the authorized JavaScript origin to localhost port 4567 as configured in the sample. Also, set the protocol to HTTP. After you've created your client ID and client secret, you're ready to clone the project. Run the git clone command to clone the Python Quickstart from GitHub. Next, set up Python as you would do for any other Python project. And so I'll just use virtual environment. Next, go into the project folder and then install all of the Python requirements by running pip install -r requirements.txt. After the requirements are installed, you're ready to set the client ID and client secret in client-secrets.json. Copy and paste the client ID from the API console project you created, and copy the client secret from the API console project. After you've put the client ID and client secret in, you're ready to run the sample. Just run python signin.py to start the sample. You'll be prompted for turning on the web server, so just make sure that you approve it, and then navigate in a web browser to localhost port 4567, authorize the application, and you will see it run. You've now run the Python Quickstart. So that's it. That's how long it takes to run through the Python Quickstart. And we timed me, and it took me just about 2.5 minutes. So it's really easy to do, and you can see it going right out the gate. But you're probably asking, what are the next things you can do with the Python Quickstart? And so some of the things that we thought about doing were deploying it to a cloud-hosted service, such as Heroku or App Engine. Ali, are there any changes that would have to be made inside of the Quickstart sample in order to be capable of deploying it to these solutions?
So this is what I really like about your Quickstart sample, is that you use a web framework called Flask. It's very close to my heart, written by a number of people I know and I've contributed to. It's a very light framework. It's very easy to use. And of course, with Python, as with any Python web framework, it's built on WSGI, the web server gateway interface, that is this common infrastructure for web applications to talk to web servers. So really, no, you can just dump that thing anywhere you like, and it will run. So it will run on App Engine. App Engine supports WSGI. It will run on Heroku. It will run on just about any way you can host files. If you just have an Apache server, well, that will work too. So that's what I really like. Flask, check it out. If you haven't checked it out and you use Python at all, you would have checked it out already. But if you haven't and you're getting into that, check it out. It's like almost the anti-Django. It's like a light, useful, flexible framework, whereas Django is a less light framework.
Yeah, I mean, in our sample, we were really trying to get it down as narrow as possible and make it as easy for developers to use. And it's good to hear that you agree with some of the choices that we made. And you're on the Drive API, so you probably have done sort of these integrations before with between the sign-in solution and Drive. So do you have any suggestions for developers and sort of what would they do to get Drive integrated, and then what would be something cool that someone could do after integrating with Drive?
So we have Drive Quick Starts as well, very similar. The Python one is very similar. We actually don't need a web server to use the Drive API, so we just have a command line application. So it's kind of easier in that way. Integrating plus sign in is very easy. You go through and you add the Drive scope, that's an OAuth2 scope, and you add that scope, and then immediately you can start making requests to the Drive API. It's beautiful because the scopes you request when you do authorize the user, those are all unioned together. So I can then get a client, an authorized HTTP client, that can make requests against the Drive API, and make requests against the Plus API, and make requests against any of our APIs, really. You just have to ask for access. So that's really, really nice. What our quick starts do is we just upload a file. So in your use case, I think the most simple functionality, and you've done that really well, is just to find out who the user is, mm-hmm. or find out their friends, or something like that. At quick start, we just upload a file. So you select a file and you upload it.
Yeah.
Pretty simple, but get on. One extra thing I just wanted to talk about was your use of virtual environment. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm really, really happy to see that. And since you brought me on to talk about Python, I guess I should just bash my stick a bit, which is when you run a Python sample, or when you install a Python sample, always use virtual environment. Why? Because you don't want to actually use your system Python. The system Python is there for the system to run. And we're well past the days when Ubuntu system or a Mac system wouldn't actually need Python installed. But now these systems use Python, and they use them in depth for lots of core functionality. So when you're installing something using sudo pip install, you have the ability to really overwrite something that the system is using and something that is critical for the function of your computer. You don't want to do that. So my takeaway for this is, if you have to run sudo pip anything, you're probably doing something wrong. So check out virtualenv, obviously check out pip. Pip and virtualenv written by the same guy originally, so they integrate very, very well. One will install the other. So that's my tip to take away. Always use a virtual environment, and thanks for doing that, because that's made me very happy.
Okay, good. Well, I'm glad to have made you happy, Ali. Do you have any questions for me about Google Plus?
So tell me, I've seen it a bit, I've seen your API a bit. So just in a few lines, tell me why Plus sign-in? Why is that good for me? Why is that good for my applications?
Yeah, well, one of the key things that we're doing in the sample is getting that client authorized as well as the server. So you can then, using the Google Plus sign-in API, by connecting your account with Google, what you're doing is you're authorizing the client on JavaScript, and you're authorizing the server. So then you can do all of those operations that you want to do client-side as well as server-side. And because of the way that the client libraries work, you can then, as you said, request all the scopes that you want, and then get access to the entire suite of functionality that is available through the Google platforms. So this is kind of a really powerful tool for developers to get their users, integrating Google functionality with their actual third-party sites.
Okay, that's cool. So I get authorization and I get authentication as well.
Yeah.
Okay, awesome. Great. So I'm a real fan. It's something I've been using in my pet projects. It's just so much easier to just put a bit of HTML on a page, and then sign in auth is just solved for me. So I love that. Yeah. So thanks very much. Keep that up.
Yeah, for sure. And that's pretty much it for the Python Quick Start. Inside of that Quick Start, what's happening is that the client's authorizing, it's passing an authorization code to the server, and then the server is authorizing, so then both are authorized. And then some of the API calls are performed on the client, most notably the profile retrieval. And then some of the APIs are performed on the server, which is that circles the people list. And so the sample just kind of highlights those two steps for using the Google Plus API.
So it was 3 minutes to go through, but I think you can easily spend a few hours picking the bits out that are useful to you for your application.
Yeah, it's really worth mentioning that you can go to the Google APIs Explorer to sort of see the scope of what you can do with the APIs and experiment with those particular API calls. So this is kind of a great pro tip. If you go to code.google.com/APIs/Explorer, you can you can explore the APIs and experiment with what's there. So that's kind of a really great place to sort of explore what you can do after you've got that sample going. So that's pretty much what we have for today. There's a couple of announcements before we close. The first is that now the People Search API will allow you to search for a Google Plus user by email. And the next is that there has been a recent update to the Android Google Play services libraries that that improves the experience for sharing and signing in on Android. So for those really astute Google Plus developers out there, make sure that you check out the new platform functionality, and feel free to ask us questions in the Google Plus developers community. And if you're looking for the Google Plus developers resources, the top ones will always be listed at developers.google.com/plus. So thanks for watching, and come back next week for another Google Plus Developers Live.
Thanks.